Somehow I click the wrong button. Okay, I guess we can start, right? Okay, so first thing, can you see the blackboard page, assignment project submission page? Hello guys. Okay, thank you. Then as I mentioned yesterday, the tutor has released the marking scheme. Okay, you can see the marking scheme is here. So basically, the last tutor, right? Xi Rui Ni utilized this marking scheme to create your assignment one. Then if you have any issue, please first contact the tutor. Okay, so this is every point is important. Okay, so make sure if you your assignment one didn't get the grade you expect, then make sure you understand why the point was deducted. Okay. Okay, so let's continue. Okay, yesterday, actually we finished the virtualization of a process. As I mentioned, that's the most difficult part in operating system design. It's impossible to utilize two lectures to finish that part. So we only give you a very brief introduction about the process. However, if you really want to know the details, we provide several references. For example, XV6 from MIT course. And we also introduce a simulator we designed, and we use it for elite stream students before. Then basically utilize those material. Hopefully can help you to understand better, okay? But no matter what, in the end, if you really want to understand those topics, you need to design and implement a small operating system. Maybe next year, the year after next year, in 2 years, I will develop a new course related to the operating system implementation. Okay, then welcome. If you are still here, then please join me to enjoy the implementation of OS. Yeah. So I want to do a little bit of promotion here. Yeah, so you know, it's hard to find a student who really want to implement something, right? So particularly for operating system, this is a kind of, you know. Okay, so anyway, today let's go to CPU scheduling. Okay, so after we introduce process, let's go to CPU scheduling. This is related to your homework three. Okay, today's topic related to your homework three. Okay, so before I continue, I want to make sure we are on the same page. Can you guys see part one, scheduling introduction, this slide? Okay, thank you. Okay, let's see. I think last time we introduced abstraction, then one of the major topic is related to how to do CPU sharing. The problem is that when we have multiple processes, then when we only have limited number of CPU cores, how to schedule processes to run on limited number of CPU, okay? So we start here, we discuss several scheduling strategy. We start with a very simple example as we always use, right? When we talk about file system, we also utilize the simple examples. Here, let's start with some simple assumption, then later we will extend those assumptions, okay? Make it more and more realistic. So let's start with those assumptions. Okay, the first one, suppose we have each job runs for the same amount of time. So here, basically, this job can be, it's a more general term, represent a process, okay? So you can think about this is equivalent to a process. Each process runs for the same amount of time, okay? Then all jobs arrive at the same time, okay? So basically, we have this two assumptions. Each job with the same amount execution time and arrive at the same time, then we don't have any other operations involved in those jobs. So basically, we only use CPU. So for example, no IO and so on. Then last assumption is that the running time of each job is known. So we already know everything, okay? Then when we talk about scheduling, we have to look at some performance metrics because when we evaluate different scheduling mechanisms, we have to have some standards. One of metrics we look at is the turnaround time. So turnaround time is very obvious. Okay, basically, turnaround time is the time at which the job complete at the time we complete this job minus the time at which the job arrive in the system. Okay, so basically, I think everyone has this kind of experience in Hong Kong when we join a queue in order to take a bus, right? So the time we join the queue, arrive, this is arrival time, right? Then until the time we get on the bus, boarding time, okay? Basically, that's the turnaround time. This also is the fare, right? So basically, we do care about this time. So if it takes too long to get on the bus, then we will complain. Oh, so why is so slow, right? Something like that. Okay. So the equation is here: turnaround time equals completion time minus arrival time. This is a major performance metrics at this moment. Okay, later we will add other performance metrics. Then another metric is fairness. Okay, so basically, we want to see that, okay, everyone should have the same chance. For example, our bus waiting queue is fair in the sense that if you come early, then you should get on the bus early, right? So basically, however, if we look at this turnaround time and fairness, sometimes, okay, they are not consistent, okay? If you want to optimize fairness, usually you will hit, usually you will hurt the performance, okay? Vice versa, okay? So you will see. Let me show some example. So suppose we utilize our fast waiting queue approach. This approach we summarize as first come, first serve approach. Okay, very simple and easy to implement. So I think everyone learn when this structure called queue, right? First in, first out, right? So basically, it's simple, right? You use a list, you can implement this kind of a queue. Then, in the beginning, based on our assumption, suppose we have three jobs A, B, C. Okay, A arrived just before B, B arrived just before C. Okay, then each job has same execution time, 10 seconds. Then you can see that our schedule is like this. A, because A arrived a little bit just before B, right? So we have A, B, C. Then A arrived time and B arrived time, C arrived time, both, all of them are the same. So basically it start at zero, okay? Then completion time A finish, because we schedule A first, A finish at 10, B finish at 20, C finish at 30, okay? Then you can see that here is our average turnaround time. So basically our turnaround time is completion time minus arrival time. So for A is 10 minus zero, 10, B 20 minus zero, and so on. Then in total, we have three tasks, average 20 seconds. Okay, trivial, right? So next, okay, so let's look at a more realistic situation. So maybe some jobs has different execution time. Oh, each job may have different execution time. Okay, in this case. So for example, suppose A has very long execution time. For example, A's execution time is 100. B and C each is 10 seconds. Okay, then suppose A arrived before B and C. So A is scheduled first. Okay. Then you can see here is the schedule. A schedule first, then we have B, then we have C. The same schedule with the case one. Then in case two, because A's execution time is very long. Okay, you can see A's execution time is 100, right? So basically A's turnaround time is 100. B's turnaround time is 110. Same situation. However, because we schedule A first, then B's completion time becomes 110, then arrival time is zero, then basically this is 100, turnaround time is 110, then C's turnaround time is 120, right? So put them together, divide by number of tasks, the average turnaround time is 110. Okay, can we do better? Suppose we want to optimize average turnaround time. How to do that? Okay, simple. Okay, so a very simple approach can help us improve average turnaround time. So the principle here is that run the shortest job first. Okay, then the next shortest, and so on. So suppose here we don't have a pre option, so which means we don't force a task to stop, then schedule another task. So then you can see that for the same situation we have in case two here, A, B, C, A's execution time is 100. Then if we follow our shortest job first strategy, although A, B, C arrive at the same time. However, because we run shortest job first, so we will run B, C first. Okay, then we run A. Same situation, right? A, B, C. A's execution time is 100, B and C each is 10. So you can see right now, our average turnaround time become 15. The reason is that you can see B and C, right, is 10 and 20. Then A is 120, then divide by 3, then total is 50. So this is a big, big improvement. Think about that. Originally, in case 2, we have 110 seconds. Then if we use shortest job first approach, the average turnaround time is 15. So in this case, actually, this is the optimal solution. Okay, in computer science, we like to describe optimal solution. This you cannot do better than this. Okay, actually, shortest job first can optimize the single CPU scheduling. Okay, if we just run the shortest job first, then basically we can achieve the optimal performance in terms of turnaround time, only turnaround time. Okay, remember turnaround time. Okay. So any question at this moment? Simple. Okay, so however, we may have this situation. You can see that we want to use shortest job first. However, suppose we relax our assumption tool, make it more realistic. Okay, jobs can arrive at any time. So in this case, you can see that B and C arrive at 10. Okay, A arrive at 0. So we schedule A first, then B, C arrive. However, sorry, no preemption. If we schedule a task to run, then we don't stop this a task. We will wait until this task finish. So then after we finish is 100, then we schedule B and C, okay? Then basically here is different from our case two because arrival time is different, right? Our arrival time here is 10. Right? So then you can see B and C here. Sorry, where's my mouse? Mouse is here. Then B finish 110. Arrival time is 10, right? Then C finish time, completion time 120. Arrival time is 10. Then finally we get average turnaround time. So we know the optimal solution is 15 seconds. You can see here, this number is not very ideal. So basically it's too much, two times from our optimal solution, right? So what can we do? Okay, so we can add the preemption to shortest job first approach called preemptive shortest job first, PSGF. So the idea is like this. Okay, when a new job enters the system, we will determine, look at the remaining jobs and the new jobs, then schedule the job which has the least time left. Okay, so it's kind of similar to the shortest job first. However, the time is when a new job enter into the system, this arrival time, at that arrival time, we will say, okay, now I want to reevaluate the whole situation. I will look at each job, then look at whose time left is shortest. Then I will schedule that job to run first. Okay, so which means we may put a preemption here. Preemption means, okay, so we will force the current running job if that may not be the least time left, with the least time left, then basically we will force this task to be ready, right? Then schedule the shortest the job to run at this moment. Okay, so give you an example, then you know what I'm talking about. So suppose still is a previous situation. A arrive at zero, then A run, then at time 10, B and C arrive. At this time, follow our preemptive shortest job first. Basically, we'll say that to look at the time left, A time left is 90, B and C is 10. So we will schedule B and C first. So B, C here, then we finish, then run A, okay? Then ideally, of course, when we do this preemption, remember last time we talked about context switch. When we schedule a new task to run, certainly we need to save some context, which is overhead. But ideally, if this kind of a switch does not take any time, then we can achieve the optimal solution. Okay, so that's the situation. So you can see that with preemptive shortage job first, basically we can still reach to the optimal solution in terms of average turnaround time. Okay. So before I go to the next topic, let me respond to some questions. So let me see the first. I think I got some questions here. So if you have any other questions, then please. Please input your question, okay? Or you can ask directly. So we talk about several simple approach. Scheduling metrics fairness is talk about, yeah. So we will talk about fairness, okay? We will define fairness later, okay? Later we'll talk about fairness, okay? So is fairness will be discussed later. Another question is, as shortest completion first, like a coroutine. So I don't know what coroutine you are talking about. Yeah, I think it depends on definition of coroutine. So, but no matter what here, basically we are not talking about any specific implementation. We're talking about strategy, right? Strategy, right? So basically we will see that, if we want to do the scheduling, then we look at the execution time of each job, then schedule the shortest job first. Shortest, the least time left job first. Yeah. So here, basically, to answer Anthony's question. So basically, because we talk about strategy here, we talk some concept. So basically, our assumption is that yes, context switch is negligible at this moment. But in reality, we have to consider that, right? How does CPU know? I think I got, I got several questions related to the CPU. How CPU know, right? So basically I look at several questions, but looks like the question related to how CPU know the execution time of a job, right? That's a very good question. So very good question. So yeah, so this is why we need to design our algorithm, because if we at this moment our assumption is that we know. However, in reality we don't know. Right? Now how can we solve this issue? Yeah. So we will answer those questions later, but right now we only talk about some philosophy. So don't worry, okay, we will solve that problem. That's also the most difficult one. If we don't know, we don't have any knowledge about the running time of a process, but we still can make a schedule and optimize the turnaround time. Now how to do that? So this is a tooling award type question, you know? People solve this problem, then got tooling work, okay? So you guys ask a very good question, right? So you guys has the potential to get tooling award. Great, okay. Okay, so let's go back. Then maybe later I will go back to answer some questions, more questions, right? So then another performance metric is related to the fairness. See, original one here, it arrived first, right? However, because A execution time, A's execution time is longer than others. Then if we have a lot of shorter jobs than A, then A may always wait, right? So it's not fair, right? So if we consider fairness, then this is why shortest job first or shortest completion job first may not be a fair strategy. Okay. So we look at another performance metric called response time. So response time is, you can see the time from when the job arrived to the first time it is scheduled. So basically T first run minus T arrival. Okay, this is what we call response time, okay? Shortest completion first strategy, those kind of principle are not particularly good for the response time, right? So then the question is that how can we do better, right? In terms of this response time. So it's very simple, okay? If we want to optimize response time, then we can utilize a approach called time slicing scheduling. Okay, basic idea is that we divide our time into a time slice. Then for each job, we run a time slice, then switch to the next job in the run queue until all jobs are finished. Then this, how to determine the time slice, actually this we call a scheduling quantum. So based on this quantum, then we schedule a new job to run. Then we repeatedly do this kind of scheduling in a round robin manner usually until all jobs are finished. Okay. So how to determine this time slice? Then basically we can utilize this based on our time interrupt period. So for example, every 10 milliseconds, we will trigger my interrupt. Then we can use this as a base to do the scheduling, right? Then in this way, every time, suppose we just directly use this the time interrupt period, 10 milliseconds as our scheduling quantum or time slice. Then basically every 10 milliseconds, we just schedule a new task to run and so on. So this we call round robin scheduling. Okay, round robin is fair, but the performance poorly on kind of performance if we talk about turnaround time, right? So let's look at. Look at the example. Suppose ABC arrive at the same time, then they each around for 5 seconds. Then if we look at our average response time, basically we have 0 + 5 + 10, right? Arrival time, completion time, first running time minus arrival time, right? So generally speaking, we got this average response time is 5 seconds. This is not it's not good, okay? So if we have a time slice of 1 second, suppose we cut our time slice into 1 second, okay? Then our average response time become 0 + 1 + 2. Then basically it's 1 second, right? So you may say that we can even get better, right? Cut into even smaller times less, then we can get better response time, okay? So this is a kind of a trade-off, right? So the shorter times less, we have better response time. However, don't forget the context switch. So if we cut too small, then if we have too many context switch, then basically this will dominate the overall performance. On the other side, if we have longer times less, then we can amortize the cost of switch. Okay, so basically if the context switch time compared to the times less we allocated to a particular job to run is very, very tiny, then this context switch time overhead is too small. Then basically we can amortize this cost of this overhead, right? However, the response time become worse because basically if you make it longer, the correspondingly response time become worse. So this is a trade-off, then how to decide the length of the time slice. Okay, this is a trade-off, basically. Okay. Also, it's very obvious. Okay, so response time actually is, if we want to be fair and also optimize response time, actually we can use the round robin manner, then give each task a time slice to run, then in a round robin manner, then basically we can optimize the response time, okay? I guess this is a kind of clear, okay? It's not it's obvious, right? So let me finish this part. So we can go to multiple level feedback queue, which answer some questions you ask. For example, we don't know the execution time. How can we optimize turnaround time? At the same time, we also want to be fair. How can we optimize the response time? Okay, so something like that. So multiple level feedback queue can achieve that. So anyway, so another issue is related to IO, okay? So a lot of process involve IO operation, okay? For example, suppose AB run 50 millisecond CPU time, okay? However, a alternatively issue IO request. Actually, every 10 milliseconds, it will issue one IO request, and the IO takes 10 milliseconds. So the impact here is that because we issue IO, A does not need the CPU. Okay, CPU is idle. If we schedule A, then CPU is idle. B simply use CPU for 50 millisecond and without any IO. Okay, so the scheduler run A first then B. Okay, you can see here, suppose we run A first, then we don't do any specific optimization, then A will run until finish, because every 10 milliseconds, A will issue one IO request. It takes 10 milliseconds also. So you can see here, CPU is idle, CPU is idle, CPU is idle. IO is busy, IO is busy, right? Basically, okay. Then after we finish, then we run B, okay? In total, we have 140, okay? Right? 140, right? So because we need 1, 2, 3, 4. For this idle time is 40, right? Every 10 seconds, we issue an IO. So we have 4 IOs. Okay, then we finish, right? Okay. So a perfect solution is like this. You can see we can still finish in 100 if we don't consider context switch, right? So then the idea here is that, okay, we can cut our we can interleave the execution of A and B. So B can be put into the idle time of CPU here. So we schedule B to execute it, right? Then after IO finish, then we schedule A again and so on. So if we can interleave IO and CPU, then we can get a perfect solution, right? So we always want to do this. Okay, we try to do interleaving. This also is very common technique when we want to optimize the execution time of application. Usually, application may need IO or network jobs. Okay, then during that time period, then we can schedule other jobs to run, so we can interleave the execution. Then basically we can optimize the performance, right? Okay, so here to show more background, when a job initiates an IO request, the job is blocked, waiting for IO completion, the scheduler should schedule another job on the CPU, right? So when IO complete, when we issue interrupt, then the OS moves the process from the blocked back to the ready state to schedule to run, something like that, okay? So generally speaking, that's the approach we should do to do interleaving. So with this, basically, we finish this part, okay, the first part, introduction part. Next week, I'm going to talk about a multiple level feedback queue, which is a tooling award work. Okay, you can see tooling award is not difficult to get. If you are the first one, for example, you guys ask a question, right? About that, if we don't know the job execution time, then at the same time, we want to optimize the response time. We want to optimize turnaround time and so on. We also interleave IO with computation. So how can we do the scheduling, right? So if you guys are the first person to identify those issues and solve those issues, then you get tuning. Okay. So anyway, so today is basically we talk about three things. Turnaround time. Basically, we have shortest job first or shortest completion first, right? this approach, we can optimize turnaround time. Okay. Then we also talk about response time. Response time, we can use time slice, round robin manner, round robin scheduling, right? Based on the time slice. So the idea is that each job will run a time slice, then schedule another one in a round robin manner. Then we also talk about interleave IO with the computation. Okay, so last one, we talk about this, right? Through the, for example, interrupt. Okay, so this is three things we talk about. So mainly here, actually, we are talking about the concept. Okay, so next one, multiple level feedback queue will be more realistic to solve the problem. Okay. So I'm ready to answer some questions. So I look at, we have a lot of questions here. Yeah, so let me copy those questions. Then if you have other questions, please continue. Yeah, please continue to input your question into the chat box, or you want to, you can ask directly. Okay, can you guys see the question? Hello, guys. Okay, thank you. Let me see. So I think I didn't get the coroutine question. That maybe if you want me to answer the question, then you have to clarify the question. Right? So I think I talk about the that context switch, right? So next question. So the CPU always need to check the time left for different jobs because it doesn't know when new job will come. Okay, so this is a good question, right? This is a good question, right? So our idea is that we cannot know this. We cannot know such information, right? So, for example, how can we know the execution time left for a particular process? We have no idea. It totally depends on application, right? So, no idea. So, so we have to do scheduling without this kind of information. So, of course, here, to talk about the simple strategy, we have the assumption we know those information. However, in reality, we don't know. Then the difficult part is that if we don't know such information, still the difficult part, right, is we want to optimize, for example, turnaround time and the response. Both, right? Without knowing, right? Such information, for example, completion time, or the left completion time. Yeah, then how to do it, right? How to do it. Right? So we'll talk about multiple level feedback queue. You can see, utilize this approach, we can kind of solve the problem. Okay, so next question. If there are many short jobs coming, the long will never be completed. Yeah, this is a very good observation. Okay, so this is called starvation, right? So later we will talk about, okay. So we need to avoid this kind of situation, right? So you don't want to have a starvation, right? So a longer job will never have a chance to be scheduled or finished, right? So then we go here. We also want to, the difficult part is want optimize this. without knowing such information and without starvation, right? So we have to consider this, right? So you can see the issue. You guys are very smart, identify those issues. Yeah, so I think next question is how can CPU estimate this time? Then the answer is the CPU cannot. CPU cannot estimate. Of course, we can always estimate, right? The issue here is that how accurate it is. If in most cases the estimate is wrong, then basically, yeah, it may not be very useful. And cannot accurately do this estimation in general, right? I'm not saying that we cannot do for a specific example, for a specific scenario. So maybe we can do it for a specific application or a certain situation. However, in general, we cannot do this. But basically, go back to this question. We don't need, right? Without knowing such information, we still can do very good scheduling. So that's the difficult part. How does CPU know the, same question, right? So I think my answer is the same, right? So we don't need to do this kind of thing, right? We don't need to do this kind of prediction or estimate. We can still do a very good scheduling. So, yeah, so this is also a very realistic question. How CPU know the execution time, running time without knowing it, right? So if we don't run it, then we don't know how long it takes. Also, in a lot of cases, even we run it we only know for a certain data, the execution time. If we change the data set, then the execution time may be totally different, right? So it depends on the input, also the different data set. So basically it's very hard to estimate running time. Okay, I think the same question, a lot of the question, then I will say, yeah, we don't need, right? So I will remove some question here because I don't have space here. So basically my answer is that we cannot do that. And also we don't need, right? We don't need to do that. So there will be a lot of overhead. I think this may be related to the estimate, the execution time of a process. So basically, we will not do any estimation. We will not do any estimation. Yeah, so our scheduling can magically handle this job, okay? Without knowing anything, then we can do this, yeah. So just the wonder is round robin related to the idea of time sharing. Okay, so time sharing is a concept, right? You think about it. Time sharing is a concept, right? So I said, okay, we will have time sharing, then, but RR is more approach to implement time sharing. It's an approach for implementation, right? So basically this is a concept, time sharing is a concept. RR is a specific strategy to implement time sharing, right? So we have a different way. For example, our shortest time first also is one way to share for time sharing. you may say, oh, this is not fair, but it's not fair, but still it's a time sharing approach, right? So different job share the CPU, but maybe some job will never have a chance to run, right? But it's still is sharing, right? In what kind of vision is response time is more important? Response time is very important, right? In any situation is very important. For example, if we have a server here to serve many people, then we need to feel that we don't wait here. Right? So in our modern operating system, at any time we run at least several tens processes. If we don't have this kind of, we don't care about the response time, then you may see that I run an application, I just wait over there for a very long time. Then, for example, I open a home page, I want to access a particular website, then it takes very long time. Yeah. So I want to run my Word, click my keyboard, then input the key, input a character, then it takes very long to respond, right? So response time is very important. Yeah. So I hope I answer your question. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I think I answered some questions. Okay. I hope I answered those questions. But see, if you are not clear, then please continue to input a question. Yeah. So let me copy more questions. Yes. Okay. Every time, this question, every time we create, we have to switch to OS to do the scheduling, right? Every time we create a process. So this is a more related to the details, right? So in some cases, basically when we do fork, right? Think about that. When we do fork, we will trap into the kernel, as we mentioned yesterday, right? Trap into the kernel and create a process and put it into ready queue. Put it into the ready queue. Into the ready queue, right? So in terms of when we will do scheduling or not, okay, depends on our scheduler, right? So this is a kind of a two different usually, right? Usually scheduler is different from this system call service. So scheduler is more or less relate to our time interrupt. We have a time interrupt, then based on certain period, we will see, oh, now we need to do scheduling. Okay, then we call scheduler. Then scheduler will say, oh, now I want to determine which process to run. Okay, whether or not we will do switch or not, something like that, right? So this is two different processes, basically. When we create a process, usually we use a system call. Then this is a kind of system call service. Then scheduling is another service we provide. But based on a certain period, we will run scheduler. So to be more specific, when we create process, we will trap into the kernel to create this process. But whether or not we do scheduling is depends on the that period scheduling quantum and so on. Yeah, so jobs, I think maybe I missed this question, but maybe it's related to the previous question, right? Create the job or project. So is this clear? Did I answer your question? Okay, any other questions? Yeah.
Can I ask that how if it scheduled without knowing the estimate the time?
Yeah, so my question is, my answer is that scheduling does not need to know this information.
So how
is it? Yeah, so we will discuss this next week. If you cannot wait, please go to look at the multiple level feedback queue. So the idea is very simple. Basically, we have multiple level queue. Then if a job comes, then we have an assumption. We will assume that this job will be finished in short time period. So if after a while, we find, oh, this job cannot be finished, then we know, oh, this guy may require longer time. Then we move this job into a lower priority queue, right? The idea is like this, okay? So, but that's the topic we'll discuss the next week, yeah. But it's a very good question, okay? Yeah, so as I mentioned, this is the tooling award type of question, right? Mankei, you have potential to get tooling award, yeah. So I hope I answer your question, right? I know I didn't give you an answer, but I'm waiting for next week to tell you the story. Okay, so any other questions? Looks like no more question. Okay, so don't forget today's tutorial, then relate to your assignment two and the project. Yeah, please make sure you attend if you don't know how to do assignment two. Okay, so that's all for today. I will see you next week. Okay, stay safe and healthy.